The Phlebotomy Textbook, Chapter 3, Safety and Infection Control, Part 1. Please see the eLearn PowerPoint for learning outcomes and key terms. The study mate has definitions of the key terms. This chart tells you about the different types of hazards. A biological hazard is an infectious agent, such as bacteria, fungal, viral, or parasitic that can cause infection. A sharp hazard is something such as needles, lancets, or broken glass that can cause cuts, punctures, or exposure to bloodborne pathogens. A chemical hazard could be something such as a preservative or a reagent. And exposure to these agents can cause poisonous, caustic, or carcinogenic effects. A radioactive hazard can come from equipment that has or radioisotopes such as reagents in testing, but you would not be exposed to this to reagents as a phlebotomist. Radioisotopes can cause damage to fetus or generalized overexposure to radiation. Electrical hazards can come from ungrounded or wet equipment or frayed cords and can cause burns or shocks. A fire or explosive hazard can come from open flames and organic chemicals and can cause burns or dismemberment. A physical hazard can be something as simple as wet floors, heavy boxes, or just patients who may hit you. So you can get falls, sprains, or strains. This is a diagram of biological hazards, chain of infection, and it talks about infection control. You should, if you look at this chart, you'll notice that when we talk about breaking these chains that can lead to a new infection, that hand hygiene breaks most of more chains in this chain of infection than any other single item. So we could start with one of the chains, susceptible host. So patients, elderly, newborns, immunocompromised, and of course, as a healthcare worker, you could potentially be a susceptible host. So to break this link, you can do that with immunizations, patient isolation, nursery precautions, or healthy lifestyle. The infectious agent link would be bacteria, fungi, parasites, or viruses, and to break this link, early detection of infection or treatment of infectious agents. A reservoir is like a place where the infection resides before it gets to the susceptible host. So it could be another person, animals, insects, fomites, blood or body fluids. So a fomite is an inanimate object that you might touch and get an infection from. So a doorknob, a mouse on a computer, a light switch, something like that. So to break this link, you're going to have disinfection, like cleaning up, and hand hygiene. So portal of exit means how does the infectious agent get out of you? So that would be through the nose, the mouth, mucous membranes, or from specimens that have come out of the person. So to break this link, we're going to seal biohazardous waste containers, sealed specimen containers, hand hygiene again, and standard precautions. So a means of transmission is next. So different organisms are spread different ways. So we heard about this a lot during the COVID pandemic. We had droplet. We thought it was droplet. And then we eventually learned that it was airborne. You can have contact, so that's where, like, touching. Vector is like a mosquito, or vehicle would be like a fly moving a disease from one place to another. So we're going to break this link through hand hygiene, standard precautions, our personal protective equipment, and patient isolation. A portal of entry is how does it get into your body? So it can go in through your nose, right? You're breathing in through your mouth, if eat, like eating something. Mucous membranes, skin. So if you get like a cut on your skin, using unsterile equipment, which of course we wouldn't do. But to break this link, of course, we're going to use hand hygiene, standard precautions, personal protective equipment, and sterile equipment. The components of the chain of infection include infectious agents such as bacteria, virus, parasite, or fungus, a reservoir where the agent is in the environment before taking a new host. The portal of exit is how the agent leaves the host. Means of transmission is how an agent moves from one person to another or from a reservoir to a host. The portal of entry is where the agent enters the body, such as a cut, a bite, blood or body fluids coming in contact with mucous membranes, or inhalation. A susceptible host is someone who will become ill if they are exposed to an agent. Someone who is immunized may be less susceptible than a person who is not immunized. It is extremely important for you to do your part in preventing healthcare-associated infections. This is why it is important for you to wash your hands before and after contact with a patient and to always wear gloves. We have many bacteria that are resistant to antibiotics, and they can spread from person to person. An infected person, these things, if spread from person to person, can then infect a person later in life. Organisms that live on your skin can easily transfer from one person to another. The CDC tracks the diseases and organisms that are commonly spread in healthcare facilities. MRSA, TB, VRSA, and VRE are organisms that are difficult to treat because they are resistant to antibiotics. These are conditions that can limit phlebotomist patient contact, and nursing staff may have to collect the blood samples. Chickenpox, conjunctivitis, diarrheal diseases such as C. diff, hepatitis A infection, herpes zoster or shingles, impetigo, influenza, mumps, lice, pertussis, respiratory syncytial virus, rubella, scabies, strep throat, tuberculosis. So work status varies by healthcare facility regulation, is determined by the employee health department, and may require physician's clearance. You should be trained and able to perform the procedure required for isolation before you enter a patient's room. This must be done by the employer. If you have not been adequately trained and cleared to enter an isolation room, the blood must be collected by authorized staff. This slide lists procedures and practices that can prevent transmission of disease. Hand hygiene is the number one way of preventing transmission of disease. Next, you must wear the appropriate personal protective equipment. Normal equipment would be gloves, lab coats, and masks. Additional PPE may be required for patients who have highly transmissible diseases or who are highly susceptible to disease. To prevent yourself from getting ill, you should have a good diet, adequate rest, a lower level of stress, and regular exercise. Hand hygiene. Guidelines are published by the CDC and the Occupational Safety and Health Administration, or OSHA. Hands should always be washed before patient contact, when gloves are removed, before leaving the work area, and any time when you have been knowingly contaminated, before going to a designated break area, and before and after using the bathroom. See Procedure 1-3 in your book. Hand sanitizing techniques for full procedural details. First, you wet your hands, apply soap, rub to form a lather for 30 seconds, remembering to wash all parts of your hands, rinse in a downward position to prevent recontamination. Use a paper towel to dry your hands, and then use a paper towel to turn off the faucet. Use a paper towel to open door handles if exiting a room that is closed, and then dispose of the towel. See procedure, again, 3-1 in your book for techniques. Personal protective equipment is also known as PPE. These are gloves, gowns, face protection, masks, goggles, face shields, and possibly respirators. Sorry, the dogs are making noise in the video. This level of PPE that you're going to see in this slide is not required in the normal laboratory area. So this level is used when inpatients or an emergency room patient that has higher level of contact precautions. This is to protect you from catching and spreading what the patient has, or to protect an immune compromised patient from catching anything from you. When donning or putting on the PPE, you must do it in this specific order: gown, mask, goggles, and gloves over gown sleeves. Once put on, you cannot leave the area and come back with this on. It must be put on and taken off in the designated area in the patient's room. See procedure 3-2, donning personal protective equipment, for full procedural details. The first step in doffing or removing PPE is to remove the gloves. First, grab the outside of the wrist and pull it down. Next, ball up the dirty glove in the hand you pulled it off with. Next, put the finger of the hand that is uncovered under the dirty glove and remove it. See procedure 3-3, doffing personal protective equipment, for full procedure details. After removing the gloves, remove goggles by only touching the earpieces. Next, remove the gown and dispose of it. And last, remove the mask. See, you can see the procedure again, but what's important is to remove the dirtiest thing first. Standard precautions were developed by the CDC by combining the recommendations of universal precautions with body substance isolation procedures. With standard precautions, you must assume that every person in the healthcare setting is potentially infected or colonized by an organism that could be transmitted. Hand sanitizing is stressed and applied to all blood and body fluids, mucous membranes, and non-intact skin. Standard precautions includes hand washing, gloves, mask or eye protection and face shield, gown, patient care equipment, environmental control, linen, occupational health and bloodborne pathogens, and patient placement. So patient care equipment, so the equipment that you're using to care for the patient may require to be cleaned afterwards. Environmental controls, so you could have filters for certain rooms. Linen has to be, people who clean this have to be trained to protect themselves from getting infected by anything that's on the linen. Patient placement, again, you have to put people who say have TB in an isolation room, something like that. Patient isolation rooms are classified by the transmission, and there is a specific PPE required for them. There are usually instructions on a door. So you say, we're going to isolate the patient based on how the disease they have is transmitted. So an airborne illness would have to have a tighter seal and have special filters. Droplet wouldn't have to have as much as airborne. And then contact would be basically, you know, just touch. So you wouldn't even need the air filters. Transmission-based precautions for airborne diseases include standard precautions, mask, or respirator. The N95 is the respirator when you hear the word respirator. Droplet precautions include standard precautions and masks. Contact precautions include standard precautions, gowns, and gloves. If you spot a sign on the patient's door that states that there is airborne precautions, you will need to ask nursing staff for instructions. If you are not trained for donning and doffing the required PPE at your facility, you should not enter this room and you should talk to nursing staff about collecting the required samples. Always follow the procedures at your facility. For droplet precautions, follow the precautions on the door and do not enter without a mask. For contact precautions, you will add a gown over your lab coat. Gloves are required for all for phlebotomy procedures, so that doesn't really change. If a patient is in isolation, you should not bring in your whole phlebotomy tray. You should take only the supplies you need. You should bring extra tubes in case there are any issues. You must dispose of any garbage or sharps in the room. The PPE must be taken off before exiting the room, usually in an anteroom for the purpose of donning and doffing PPE. Reverse isolation is designed to protect patients from infection when they are very vulnerable. This may include burn patients, the NICU, cancer patients, and transplant patients. Sterile equipment must be used and all equipment that enter the room must be removed from the room. Some PPE that may be regularly used in the laboratory is gloves and a lab coat. More recently, hospitals still require masks for all personnel, but labs not connected to a hospital may not require a mask. Face shields or countertop shields might be used for testing that may pose an increased risk of splatter. When there is biological waste disposal, the bag is usually red or orange and the hazard symbol on it. In general, phlebotomy supplies will go in the regular trash or in a sharps container. Our supplies do not usually drip with blood. Biological specimens such as samples for cultures, or the cultures themselves will go into a biohazard trash, but these are normally handled and disposed of by laboratory technicians or scientists. That's the end of this section of the lecture. Please also watch the second half of the, or listen to the second half of the lecture. Thank you.